The Paddy Power Half Hour on OTB Sports. Minimal contact in stadiums. That shouldn't stop the usual suspects from going down. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Yes, you're welcome along this Friday afternoon. It is the Paddy Power Half Hour. It's Jerry and Enda with you in studio. And our pointy-headed odds compiler this week from Paddy Power is Emmet O'Keefe. Emmet, good afternoon to you. How are you?
Good afternoon. Not bad. Looking forward to another solid weekend of football.
Yeah, and hopefully as good a weekend of tipping as we had last weekend. Normally we wait until the end to blow our respective trumpets and go, oh, it's whatever the score is. But Enda had a cracker last week. What was it, Enda?
It was 17-1 West Ham to win the first half, United to win the second half last week.
And what happened?
And it came through, but I'm happy for all the people who made money off me, but I made no money off that because my car broke down before the game. So I was concentrated on that and not actually getting any money. So I made nothing off that, despite...
You didn't even stick a fiver on it?
No.
Not a euro?
Nothing.
Not 10 cents?
The point is that I get an extra point on my table and I'm still technically level if you count the game in hand.
Well, look, there you go. Congratulations on that. And, it's... unfortunate. Let's run you through the fixtures this week. It is a decent weekend, a decent slate of games. Tonight, it's everybody's favourite second team, Leeds, who are actually playing really good football against the West Ham side, also playing good football. Tomorrow, it's Wolves against Villa at 12:30. Newcastle, West Brom, going ahead at 3:00 on Saturday afternoon. Manchester United against Manchester City, big game at 5:30 on Saturday. And then at 8:00, it's Everton against Chelsea on Sunday. This is a decent slate of games too. Southampton against Sheffield United, Crystal Palace against Spurs, Fulham against Liverpool, Leicester against Brighton, and Arsenal against Burnley. We'll give you more details on the commentary teams that we have on Sunday for you as well on the... games on Off the Ball and News Talk on Sunday afternoon. Right, we also have done our weekly poll. This one, you are a Manchester United fan, isn't it? We need to confirm this, right, Enda?
I can neither confirm or deny.
You are.
It's no, fine. I am.
Are you, Emmet?
I am.
It's funny that everybody's a Man United fan of a certain age, isn't it? It's almost like you were glory hunters because the team was winning all the time.
Can you call a six-year-old a glory hunter?
Yes, at the worst kind. Yeah. Yes. Right, if Manchester United lose, is Solskjaer done, was the poll. Yes, sack him. No, he's at the wheel. They won't lose, and he was never the man. So you can see that the language is that of a Manchester United fan. And how is it going?
I don't know if Joao actually has the poll there, but last time I checked, it was somewhere in between people saying he was never the man and then that no, he's at the wheel. So at the minute, we're at 40% on no, he's at the wheel. He was never the man is second with 27% of the vote. Yes, sack him at 24%. And they won't lose at 7%.
Solid 48% think he won't get sacked. And he was never the man. I mean, is that he was never the man, but we're not going to sack him? You have to sack him? Because that's 50-50. That's coming out 50-50 as far as I can make. Which is, everybody's on the fence about Solskjaer.
Yeah, but I suppose... the main point of this is that Solskjaer, depending on what week it is, will that poll will be completely different because people's opinions of Solskjaer changes within every single week. United have been inconsistent this year, there's no doubt about that, but the weekly change of opinion of where Solskjaer's team are at is a real frustration of mine because they win a game, he's the man, they lose a game, it's disaster. And I suppose that comes with the territory of managing a club like Manchester United, but at the same time, other managers aren't being treated in the same way. For example, Frank Lampard last year, when Chelsea were all over the place in terms of results, he didn't get the same treatment as that. So I ultimately don't think Ollie's the man who's going to lead United to a title. But I don't think it is as disastrous as it's been made out. You don't beat PSG and RB Leipzig if it's a disaster. Well, granted, they did. It's amazing that they managed to get knocked out of the group. But at the same time, I don't think United are as bad as people think.
Okay. I mean, that you are also on the fence, it turns out. It's grand, actually. You know, I don't mind being this team who are completely irrelevant when it comes to the title race, even though I'm Manchester United. I mean, come on, what are you talking about? You're accepting mediocrity. There's no way that anybody else would have at Manchester United under that Ferguson era would have allowed this to happen to the point where the team lists and gets out of the Champions League and we're like, what, December. I presume there's not that much money coming in for Ole Gunnar Solskjaer as the next manager to be sacked at the moment.
Yes, we would have seen a bit of a move on him during the week after after the loss to Leipzig, when he's now into around 2-1, I think, to be the he's 2-1 favourite now to be the next manager to leave his job. Actually, it's funny this season. Usually you see kind of a managerial sacking around this time, but I think maybe it's financial reasons, but there's been no one seems really close. I think Ed Woodward in the past has been also, I think, quite reluctant to sack managers. And so, unfortunately, I think Solskjaer will probably get more time, even if they lose the weekend. I've stayed consistent on this. I think he should have been got. The only reason he's still in the job is because United signed Bruno Fernandes. On February 2nd of last year, United were 7th in the table and 14 points behind Leicester. And I think and once Fernandes came, they were the best team in the league in that last 14-game period. I think Fernandes had totally propped him up, and I think he would have been gone definitely last, even this season again. Fernandes is the most chances created of any player in the Premier League. I think United have very little outside of him.
It's not even close as well with the number of chances created. We'll come back to that a little bit later. So your special bets this weekend, everybody's suddenly paying attention after your 70-1 last week. No pressure. What have you gone for?
Well, we're sticking mainly to the Manchester Derby this week because that's obviously the biggest game. So obviously Paul Pogba has been a conversation over the last couple of weeks and the agent situation there. So one thing that we're looking at is whether Paul Pogba will start this game. He obviously didn't start against RB Leipzig, and he came on and made a huge difference in that game. So that bet is only going to be available until tomorrow, though, because obviously the team news starts coming out. Man United to win the second half. Again, like the bet from last week, United have been scoring late on and scoring goals in the second half more than the first half, and they've been conceding a lot of goals in the first half. So United to win the second half, don't know how the first half is going to go. And again, a narrative over the last couple of weeks has been Arsenal and the amount of crosses they're putting into the box. Again, last week they had over 34 crosses against Tottenham. None of them successful, obviously enough, because they lost 2-0. Arsenal to have over 34 and a half crosses this weekend is a special bet. So, Emmet, what are those odds coming out as?
Yeah, so we Pogba at 2-1 to start at the weekend. I think it was probably telling during the week in terms of the United midfield pecking order that Donny van der Beek came out at halftime in a game United desperately needed to win, whereas Pogba came out with half an hour to go. And I don't think Solskjaer is likely to risk a midfield three with Pogba and Fernandes. So I think it's probably an unlikely starter here. United to win the second half is 11-4. This season, United are 19th in the league in first half league table. So if every game in the Premier League finished at halftime, United would be 19th in the league, whereas they're fourth in the Premier League second half table, which speaks to how volatile their performances have been this season. And then with Arsenal crosses, Arsenal 44 crosses last week, which is the highest number of any team this season, any game. They average 20 a game, so we go 11-1 that they'll have 35 plus against Burnley in what might be a bit of a struggle for them.
Right. 11-1, I was expecting to be a little bit less than that if they had 44 last week. So, any of those tickling your fancy? Do you think Pogba's going to start?
Me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are your specials?
It's a hard one to know. I mean, I think Paul Pogba is essentially, he has lost all of his power at United in terms of I am the main man. You either drop me or you sell me. And now United actually have someone in midfield to replace him. So United have regained the power in that situation. So it's hard to know. I think Pogba, if he turns up, he is United's best player. But if he's been too inconsistent, probably doesn't deserve to start over the course of his
United
form,
to win the second half?
United to win the second half, I do think that's a possibility. I don't think United are going to get hammered in this game. I think it's going to be tight. And they took the game to Man City last time and they absolutely...
You're previewing it now.
Them,
stop so doing that. Just asking if you're going to bet.
Yeah,
I
think United to win the second half.
And the Arsenal crosses, this was an interesting bet. 11-1. I mean, obviously...
I think they're great odds, in fairness, if you want to stick a euro or two on that. 11-1 for a side that have had over 34. I think they had 33 the week before that and over 34 in the last game. So they're getting a load of crosses in. None of them are being successful. But I think that's a decent price.
Those specials are on the Paddy Power website?
Yeah.
Good stuff. Okay, so look, let's go. Our Instagram polls, we put these up every Thursday. You can get involved in them before Friday around about 10 o'clock when Enda turns off the taps. We're asking you for an outright result in the games. We're going to start with Leeds United against West Ham. This is tonight at 8 o'clock, and you can talk us through this one. But Leeds, 78%. West Ham, 22%. You're not watching any football there, you Instagram viewers. You not watching any football?
I was saying this to you before the game. I wonder, are people concentrating on the football that Leeds are playing as opposed to the results that they're getting? Because obviously, they're the great entertainers of the league, but they're not matching that with their results. 14th in the table compared to West Ham, who are up there in the top six. So, like, on form and on form across the season, West Ham should win this game. But people just fancy Leeds because they're really exciting to watch. One thing, and maybe I'm just getting ahead of myself in terms of my bet last week, but one thing to look out for this in this game is West Ham's scoring in the first half and opening the scoring in the game. Six games in a row now, they've opened the scoring in their games, but they've dropped 19 points from winning positions this season. So and Leeds as well, coming into this game, 11 of their goals, of their 20 goals, so over half of their goals have come in the first half that they're conceding. So I think that West Ham will take the lead in this game, but they may not win it. So I've been looking at this game, and I think it's going to be a draw on this Friday night, but I think that West Ham might take the lead. Leeds will equalise, and we'll see what goes from there. I do think both teams are going to score. So, Emmet, what are the odds in this game?
Yeah, so we've Leeds at 11-10, the draw 13-5, and West Ham are 21-10. I think the way Leeds play in terms of kind of committing so many numbers forward with a high defensive line leaves them really vulnerable to counterattacks. And we've seen teams like Crystal Palace and Leicester exploit that. They both beat Leeds 4-1, and pacey attacking players like Jamie Vardy and Wilfred Zaha to the fore. Mikel Antonio would be an ideal player for this game, but he looks like he'll be absent. But with him absent, I'd expect Saeed Benrahma to get his first start for West Ham here. Benrahma was arguably even more influential than Ollie Watkins for Brentford in the Championship last year, and we've seen the success Watkins has had at Villa. Benrahma has superb pace and skill, and has the ability to really hurt Leeds if he's at his best. So if West Ham were to be successful in this game, I'd expect Benrahma to play.
Yeah, I would kind of have preferred Benrahma to Watkins, and I actually would probably still swap them now if you gave them to me. So just one quick question on that. If you think, if Enda thinks that there's going to be that early West Ham lead, what's the best way to parlay that into a bet?
You could back West Ham to score the first goal, or maybe West Ham draw some halftime win and then draw at full time. That would be kind of that would be the two options I'd look at. Maybe.
All right. Okay. Let's move on. Wolves against Aston Villa on Saturday. This is the 12:30 kickoff. Wolves 72%, Aston Villa 28%, and that's what the expected goals is telling you as well. Both of these sides on the crest of a slump, kind of. I really just wanted to say that. Was it Barry Venison who invented that? Don't Google it. It was. Wolves were shocking bad against Liverpool last week. Villa had the week off because of the COVID in Newcastle. Jack Grealish obviously took it handy and got his rest in like a full, solid professional should do. Good man, Jack. Villa, 4 defeats in the last 5 Premier League games. Still haven't drawn a game. So does that mean they're due a draw or, on the balance of probability? Or is that hocus-pocus mathematics? I'm not sure. Is it hocus pocus too that Wolves beat Villa really comfortably in both games last season? Adama Traore, Villa escapee, will he tear them apart again? He might do. Seriously though, Grealish is enjoying himself on the pitch as much as he is off it. As we've already mentioned, Bruno Fernandes has created more chances than him, but only Bruno and Kevin De Bruyne have created more chances for their teammates, while Grealish is among midfielders. Only Fernandes has been involved in more goals so far this term by a matter of one. Grealish scored 5 and assisted 5. Very unusual for me to say this, but I have a good feeling about Villa actually winning this game. The XG would say that it's going to be a Wolves narrow 1-0 win or something like that, but, you know, what do they know? Villa are going to win. Am I right, Emmet?
I agree with you. Yeah, I think speaking of Grealish, we've seen Wolves in playing a back four in recent weeks, and if they do, that'll put Nelson Semedo in direct opposition with Grealish, and I think that'll spell trouble for Wolves. Semedo's been a liability defensively this season, and a big downgrade of what Matt Doherty gave them last year. I think as well, you might have seen on Sky Sports there recently, they did a comparison between Eden Hazard's numbers in his last season at Chelsea and what Grealish is putting up this season, and they were eerily similar, which I think shows you the level that Grealish has been at. There'll also be question marks at Wolves over the absence of Raul Jimenez and what they're going to do in terms of the focal point of their attack. Adama Traore doesn't look in the same form as last year. Villa have 2 weeks to prepare. To me, Villa over 2-1 looks a decent better.
I like the sound of that. All right, next.
Next up is the big one of the weekend, Newcastle United against West Bromwich Albion. The most exciting game of the weekend, I think, and people are backing on our Instagram poll a Newcastle win here. Now, that's an interesting one because I think it's going to be the opposite. Newcastle are going into this game. They are the reason that game against Aston Villa was called off last week because they had an outbreak of coronavirus in their camp. They have met for the first time in 13 days on Wednesday. So they've only had a couple of days to prepare for this game after a couple of weeks off. I think that's going to be an issue for Newcastle. Lack of goals is going to be an issue for Newcastle. And I know West Brom got absolutely hammered and they're really, really bad. But you have to think, having that full week and just being on a run of games, that West Brom will be kind of excited looking into this game, that they could catch this Newcastle team on the fly. So I think West Brom are going to get a win here. Emmet, I presume that low scoring is where the odds are favouring in us.
Absolutely, yeah. So we've Newcastle 7-5, the draw 21-10, and West Brom 15-8. For as bad as Newcastle are, I think 7-5 to me looks a reasonable price. I think West Brom are possibly the worst team in the league. They are the worst team in the league by distance and expected goals, and they're missing their best player in the Championship last season in Matheus Pereira. Alan Saint-Maximin back from Newcastle, and I think Newcastle can pretty just about edge a grim affair here.
Yeah. I don't think we need to spend any more time on this.
No, I don't think so.
Let's move on. Okay, we've saved some time there. Manchester United against Manchester City, 5:30 on Saturday evening. This is the big one. Ole versus Pep. 32% of our Instagram users think that it's going to go Manchester United's way. 68% think that, you know, the manager with the European Cups and the experience and the tactical know-how is actually going to win the game. So, obviously, Man United beat West Ham last week. Come from behind victory, very important in midweek. Come from behind, go out in the Champions League. So what's the truth about where they are? Man City, back at it, rested some players midweek, still strolled to a 3-0 win. Good form from Raheem Sterling. More importantly, Sergio Aguero comes off the bench and scores. Did Manchester United beat City last season? No one's ever mentioned this. I mean, okay, so sorry. Man United fans bang on about it all the time, again and again and again. Oh, look at our results against the top six teams. Yeah. What about the bottom six and the middle six? If only you could beat up those teams you're supposed to beat, you know. Which would suggest that it's actually quite easy to beat this Manchester United team. And things are different for City this time. They have a defence. De Bruyne has teammates who aren't getting his death stare after 2 minutes in the game. Sterling and Mahrez both playing well at the same time, which I don't really remember happening before. It's the month of December. Gabriel Jesus was on the City calendar this month. I mean, I don't believe in signs, but that's a sign we can all get behind. United's such a weird team, it's very hard to know what to predict what's going to happen. And I have this feeling that they're actually getting away with stuff. That come from behind thing is like, you know, cavalry charge, spirit of the blitz. But like, it runs out. Eventually, over a period of time, that runs out. And I think that it's going to completely run out now. One caveat that I would offer, if Pep Guardiola gets in his own head and picks 5 centre-backs and 5 strikers or some weird, crazy-ass team that you only ever see in the Champions League semi-final second legs, from him, then abandon ship, get off straight away. So wait till the team news comes out, and then if City had their best players in their best positions, I'm back in City all day long and twice on Saturday. What are the odds, Emmet?
Yeah, so we've seen a bit of a move on City the last couple of days. Man United are 10-3, the draw 16-5, and City now is short as 8-11. Just, I think one thing to watch here, we saw during the week against Leipzig what happens when Bruno Fernandes is held. He gave the ball away 30 times the match at the lowest pass completion percentage of any United starter. For a bit of context, only one player gave the ball away more than 30 times over the 16 matches in the Champions League this week. And I think if City can get in his face and deny him space, I don't think United have much else to offer.
Yeah. The price, I presume, has been lengthening on Manchester United this week. Is that where the...
Absolutely, yeah. Post Leipzig, and you mentioned the kind of positives about City. I wouldn't be certain about City at all, though. Yet I think they've only beating Fulham, and Burnley wouldn't convince you of anything. And it looks like John Stones might get a start at centre half, and I have very little faith in Stones playing against some of the quick United forwards as well.
Yeah, look, if Stones plays, that's definitely wait for the team news and see what's happening. We saved ourselves 40 seconds. I'll give you 2 seconds on this if you want it. Do you want it?
It depends what United turn up. I mean, United could easily go out and absolutely hammer Man City here. That's what, you just don't know what's going to happen with them. But yeah, again,
it'd be a bit of a surprise.
Would it though? Because yes. they went out and hammered RB Leipzig 5-0 and then they lost to them during the week. You just don't know what United are going to do. If United play a wing-back formation with Aaron Wan-Bissaka as a right wing-back, then absolutely back Man City because they'll tear them to shreds.
All right. Everton against Chelsea at 8 o'clock?
Yeah, another game that you're going to want to wait and see what the team news is because Everton, again, they're playing different formations. People are back in Chelsea on our Instagram poll here and I would tend to favour that as well. Everton are playing 3 at the back at the minute because Seamus Coleman's out injured and it's just not working for them. They started with that against Burnley last week. Burnley took the lead and Burnley actually dominated the first couple of first 20, 30 minutes of that game because of that formation. Once they changed that 4 at the back, a traditional 4-3-3, they started, then Everton started to take control of the game. So depending on how they line out, I do think Chelsea will have the advantage here. One thing I do want to bring up with this game is sort of the idea behind where you want your goals coming from, because these are kind of carbon opposites of each other. So Everton at the minute obviously relying on the goals from Dominic Calvert-Lewin, 11 goals this season, but not many from other people. Chelsea have had 13 different goal scorers this year, 4 from Werner, 4 from Zouma, and then 3s, 2s and 1s across the board. So which would you prefer? Do you want a target man, a man up front that's going to do all your scoring, or do
everybody,
you want to spread it across?
Everybody weighing in.
Yeah, I think that's the way to go, because that's the way Liverpool went. The year they fell short of the title, Mo Salah obviously had unbelievable amounts of goals, but then when they won the title, everybody was scoring goals. So that's just an interesting one to look for in this game. But again, yeah, wait for the team news. If Everton are playing 3 at the back, then I think Chelsea are going to win this. If it's 4-3-3, then it's going to be a tighter affair, I think.
What's the market saying? How did you price this one up?
Yeah, so Everton are 10-3, the draw 16-5, and Chelsea are 4-6. I think that that Chelsea price of 4-6 reflects how the markets have viewed them now as opposed to earlier in the season. I think Chelsea would have gone off a much bigger price six weeks ago. I think it's possibly a reflection on the improvement that Thiago Silva and N'Golo Kante back to form has made to their defence.
And a goalkeeper.
100%, yeah.
That helps.
He made a bit of a mistake for Bamford's goal last week, but in general, he's been fairly decent, and Kepa was a total disaster last year. And so I think even a decent keeper would have been an improvement. Only Spurs have conceded fewer goals than Chelsea. Kante's averaging nearly three successful tackles a game, which is close to 50% improvement on last year. And he looks to be playing a key role in Chelsea's title push after in different form over the last couple of years.
Yeah, it's almost like playing him in the right position is helping out. Right.
100%.
Sunday. Southampton against Sheffield United. This one kicks off at 12 o'clock. 89% on Instagram think that it's going to be a Southampton win. 11% backing Sheffield United. Again, a brilliant bet from Enda a couple of weeks back. One of our specials was Sheffield United not to win a game before Christmas. I think it was about as big as 7-1 when
it was 7-1 when we started off. Yeah.
So I don't know what it is now, but it's much shorter than that because we're getting pretty close at this stage. Southampton aren't a top four team. There was some hope that maybe a couple of weeks ago they were on that run. Was it eight matches unbeaten? And this was one of those seasons that we hoped that maybe Leeds, Everton, Villa, Wolves, Leicester, Southampton could break up that monotony of the top six, but it's not going to happen. So games like this where if it was a proper, genuine top six team, you would say it's an automatic home win, and it has to be because that's what the good teams do against the little team. I just don't have that confidence. And also, I don't think Sheffield United are as bad as their results have been showing. Certainly, again, the XG has not been suggesting that they should have scored more than they actually have. We'll talk a bit more about that in a minute. But anyway, I don't think that Sheffield United are going to lose this game. I don't think Southampton are going to win it. So I think it's going to be a draw. What are the odds saying?
Yes, yeah, so Southampton 4-6, the draw 11-4, and Sheffield United 4-1. I think, to me, it's hard to see past Southampton here a bit, especially with Danny Ings back, who will help if Sheffield United are defending deep. I think one thing to watch with Southampton is be James Ward-Prowse's set-piece delivery. I'm not the first person to say this, but his set-piece delivery reminds me of David Beckham at times, with his ability to get the curl on the ball at high speed. And Southampton are taking full advantage of it this season. And they, along with Chelsea, lead the league in goals from set-pieces. And I think even if it's a tight game, Ward-Prowse's set-piece delivery could make the difference.
Yeah. Suddenly you're making me doubt myself.
Yeah, no, I think Southampton will score here, and it's one of the best to look out for this week. I think Yannick Vestergaard to score from a set piece. He's been very dangerous. I think he has 3 goals this year, and all of them have been headers. So I think that's one to look out for this week.
What kind of price are you getting on that?
6-1, I think, for any time goal scorer.
Right, okay.
Yeah, so it's fairly decent. Next game is Crystal Palace against Tottenham. So Tottenham obviously going into this heavy favourites. And according to our Twitter poll as well, they're not giving Crystal Palace much of a chance here, because obviously Tottenham top of the league, 2-0 win in the North London Derby last week. But I don't think it's going to be as easy as people like to think for Tottenham this week. So Mourinho's comments after the Arsenal game were quite interesting. He praised Arteta for the style of play and the tactics and how they were trying to play triangles. But the point of what he was making was that they were playing triangles in places that they weren't going to do any danger.
Do you think he meant it, Enda?
It was patronising, and it was a backhanded compliment, because he meant it in such a way that Arteta played into his hands in terms of the way that they played. Arsenal attacked them, put loads of crosses into the box, kept the ball, dominated possession, and Tottenham won it 2-0. And that is the way that Jose Mourinho's title sides have won games all the time. They don't play for possession, they play for wins, and they won last week again. This one is going to be a little bit different because Crystal Palace neither want possession nor attack much. So they're going to be sitting a lot deeper. So that's going to eliminate the Tottenham counter-attack that they've been scoring goals from this year. So it's going to be more difficult than people think. If Crystal Palace can hold out in this game for longer than they have been, then I do think they might be able to pull off a draw here. Wilfred Zaha, again, showing his importance to this team. He scored 2 goals when he came back last week. So I think this is going to be a low-scoring game. Tottenham might just edge it, but I don't think there's going to be many goals in it. Emmett, what do you think?
Yeah, no, I'd echo your sentiments there. So Crystal Palace are 7-2, the draw 11-4, and Spurs are 4-6. We've seen Spurs earlier in the year against Burnley and West Brom. It took them 76 minutes to break down Burnley and 88 minutes to break down West Brom. And I think we can see a staring contest here with both teams wanting to counterattack. So given that, the bet I like here would be halftime nil all at 15-8. I can see this game being very, very tight, and then maybe Spurs really going for the last half hour. As you mentioned with Wilfred Zaha, he's 7 goals in his first 9 games, which sets him up well to beat his best ever goal tally of the Premier League, which is 10. He's really benefited from the signing of Eze from QPR, which has taken some of the creative burden off him.
Somebody should sign him at Christmas, though. I mean, that's exactly the type of thing that, Manchester United, if they get rid of Pogba, sign Zaha, away you go. Everybody forgets about the Pogba era. Fulham against Liverpool, 4:30 on Sunday afternoon. Fulham obviously beaten by Manchester City last week, but not disgraced. 91% think that it's going to be Klopp hammering on Scotty Parker, taking his shoe off and beating him to death, Joe Pesci style. Liverpool very impressive against Wolves. This is another routine victory, I think, for Liverpool. You could feel reasonably happy with Liverpool -2 here. That's the kind of thing that I think is going to happen. Trent Alexander-Arnold is back. His own personal impact in XG has been put around 0.3 a game. So fire up your Sunday afternoon engines and watch Liverpool purr into top gear. That's what's going to happen here. What are the prices here? Is our poll a million miles away from what the odds actually are?
Probably a bit favouring Liverpool too much, but that's not surprising given the fan base. 15-2 Fulham, the draw 9-2, and Liverpool 3-10. I maybe expect a somewhat competitive game here because I think Fulham are playing a lot better than the first few weeks of the season. I think one thing to watch with Liverpool, be somewhat quietly, I think Mo Salah's playing the best football of his career with 9 goals in his first 10 games. But what's different from previous seasons is he's playing far more unselfishly and making key contributions to Liverpool's build-up play. In his first 3 seasons at Liverpool, Salah was averaging around 28 passes a game. And this year, that's shot up to 37 passes a game, so around a 33% increase. That's helped Liverpool sustain the best attack in the league.
Is there any indication that... how many passes? 37?
37, yeah.
36 of them not going to Sadio Mane. It's like maybe once a game he accidentally passes it to Mane.
It's funny, yeah, because earlier in the season when I think he set up Mane, kind of Mane pointedly went over and really kind of hugged him. Like, I think, yeah, Mane is really desperate for that.
Oh, there was last week where, like, there was a clear through ball pass. All he did was lay it off to him. No, screw you. No, you're not getting it. But look, that's what makes him one of the best and most interesting footballers in the world. I've nothing else to say about this.
No, I don't either. I think Liverpool are going to win it. So we may as well move on to Leicester against Brighton, the 7:15 p.m. one off the 7:15 kickoffs on Sunday evening, and people favouring Leicester here. If ever there's a side to stick the middle finger up to XG and what it means, is Brighton, because they overachieve in XG and they underachieve when it comes to the actual results. Last week again,
that'll be XG sticking its fingers up with Brighton. Come on, get it right.
Well, whatever way you want to look at it. Brighton are one of these sides that absolutely do not live up to their expectations at all. They're just above the relegation zone. They don't score enough goals. They concede far too many. They're going to play right into Leicester's hands here, and Leicester are going to win. That's my thoughts. That's my 2 cents on this. That's all I have to say.
I'm not sure, actually. I don't know.
To be fair, the one thing that Brighton have in their favour this week is that they're better away from home than they are at home. So they're averaging 1.4 points away from home this year, 0.9 points at home. So they're better away from home, but I do think they are the type of side that will attack Leicester and get absolutely done on the counter-attack by this Leicester side as well. So I think Leicester are going to win this handy enough.
Like Jack Grealish, I'm having trouble deciphering which parts of the country are going to have fans at games. I don't think the 2,000 fans make a blind bit of difference. Obviously, it did at Millwall, where they inspired the opposition team. Fair play to the opposition for sticking it to them and, like, metaphorically sticking their fingers up them. But I can't see the fans there or not being there for Leicester against Brighton having any impact. So, right, what are the odds? How do you price up a match like this?
Yeah, so we've Leicester at a slightly big price there of evens, and the draw 12-5, and Brighton 11-4. Yeah, as Enda said, it was the usual story for Brighton against Southampton last week. Better at the game, didn't take the chances, and got on the wrong side of a tight VAR decision. But one area I think where Brighton can exploit Leicester's defend is Leicester defending of set pieces. Leicester have conceded the most goals of any team in the Premier League from set plays. I think Brendan Rodgers would be desperate to get Kagler or Soyuncu back to full fitness very soon. Also, in Lewis Dunk, Brighton possess one of the best goal scoring defenders around, so I wouldn't put anyone off backing him at 11-1 to score any time. And I think, yeah, I think just Leicester just look a little bit vulnerable to me, but I think they'll definitely benefit from having Wilfred Ndidi back, yeah, who's a huge player for them.
Okay, Arsenal against Burnley is the final fixture that we're talking about this week. 62% of you crazy loons are saying that Arsenal are going to win this, and just 38%. Sean Dyche can't get no love, and he deserves some. So last week, the notes here: Arsenal beaten by Tottenham, Burnley good value for the draw against Everton, and guess which of us wrote this? If Arsenal continue their crossing against Burnley, they won't win. So Enda's obviously obsessed by a lot of things, particularly crossing in the Arsenal era.
I don't understand them.
Burnley have a very good chance of beating Arsenal, I think, although XG suggests that Arsenal should win, but then XG doesn't put the actual ball in the net. That's the other thing Enda's obsessed with. And sometimes, in fairness, even a stop clock tells the right time twice a day.
Is that a dig? Is that an old timey dig that I don't get? I've never heard that before.
Literally an old timey dig. I like the pun there, Enda. You're unintentional. Arsenal are probably favourites for this game. There's no, you can't put bad money on Arsenal these days.
I don't know. Arsenal is such an enigma. If they had Olivier Giroud playing up front,
they're not an enigma. They're bad. Yeah, that's different. They're actually just bad.
Tell me how
they're favourites, I presume.
They are. It's probably a dangerously short price of 1-2 here. The draw 3-1, Burnley 11-2. Yeah,
no.
I couldn't recommend Arsenal to beat any accumulations this weekend.
Why are they so heavy odds on?
Partly because I think Burnley have been quite poor form this season. They only beat Crystal Palace when Wilfred Zaha was absent. It's probably the market's quite negative on Burnley in their statistics, and maybe kind of saying that Arsenal have been probably maybe a little unfortunate in terms of some of their chances creation. But I don't really buy that. Like, the both teams are bottom five in the league in goals scored and expected goals, and I think under 2.5 goals here at 10-11 looks a fair price. And then don't watch the game. I think we can be pretty confident Burnley will sit deep and try and deny Arsenal space. And there hasn't been any evidence this season that Arsenal had the craft and attack to open up teams who play that way.
The under in the Burnley games is a good, solid bet week in, week out that at least gives you an interest because there's no early goals in any of those games. I just can't be seeing putting any money on Arsenal at 2-1 on. That's the fastest way to the poorhouse. Enda, anything else you want to say?
Just the bets of the week. So I ran through a couple of them there, but I suppose one of the things that we mentioned, the Leeds game and what might be a good, interesting bet in that in terms of the goals, Leeds to come from behind and draw is 6-1. So that would mean West Ham to take the lead and obviously Leeds to equalise. So I think that's a decent price for that, because obviously you're not sure if Leeds have enough to get past West Ham. So I think 6-1 on that is a pretty good price. Or Yannick Vestergaard, 13-1 anytime goal scorer, might be an interesting one to stick 2-3 euro on at the end.
What's your official bet this week, so that now when we're holding you to account next week?
I'll pick the Leeds one. The Leeds to come from behind and draw at 6-1.
All right, I'm going to pick Villa to win. I mean, I don't, you know, this is it's unlikely, but sometimes you just have to back your hunches. And the score from last week, there you go. I still lead. This is kind of unfair because Enda had a 17-1 winner last week, and mine was kind of probably an even. It was Chelsea -2 that I fluked in the last minute, where Christian Pulisic, 93.5 minutes in, made it a 3-1. So, I mean, really, we should have been keeping the amount of money, and you'd be miles ahead. But look, that's not how. That's just got to play with rules. Rules. That's the story. Emmet, anything from you before we wrap?
I would have gone Villa as my best bet, but I'd probably go Newcastle at 7-5. I'll hold my nose and back Newcastle.
Right, OK. Well, enjoy, everybody, whatever it is that you're doing, and remember to bet responsibly as well. Paddy Power, half hour with you every Friday afternoon. What else would you be doing at lunchtime? Only listen to us goons goof off about the weekend's football. We'll see you next week. Hope you enjoyed it. Cheers.
The Paddy Power Half Hour on OTB Sports. Minimal contact in stadiums. That shouldn't stop the usual suspects from going down. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.